Welcome you all to participate in the 18th lecture of the Essence on the Dharma Practice of Tibetan Buddhism. Before we start, let us request
Vajja Mastayisitaye
to lead us to recite the prayer.
Now, all Dharma friends, please follow me to recite the text on the generation of Bodhicitta. Namo, in front of our root gurus, the masters of all masters, we pay our homages to them with no differences. In order that all sentient beings will be able to attain Buddhahood, may our minds in practicing the profound yogas be completely fulfilled. Now let us invite
Vajra Master Bemahadrin
to enlighten us with teachings on the Buddhist Holy Dharma.
For the first of the 15 lectures of our Essence on the Dharma Practice of Tibetan Buddhism series have revealed the operation of the world after death. All of us, every one of us, will definitely have a chance to experience this. So, these are some very important knowledge and wisdom that we should know and develop. If you want to know more about this, make yourself available to understand and to be able to handle this in the future, do remember to review lectures 1 to 15. From the 16th lecture onwards, we have started talking about mind training. When we get to know about the existence of the world after death, as our lives will continue after death, so we will have to deal with lots of dangerous issues. And thus we need to be prepared in order to help ourselves. That is, we need Dharma practice. No wonder why, in the Buddhist religion, it always reminds us to have Dharma practice. But, what do we need to practice? Is that just to learn and practice on the rituals of certain practice methods sufficient enough to handle the situation? You will soon realize, it is not that simple. Because, in the operations of the nature, there are some patterns and rules. One of the most important rules is to exercise certain control over the power of our mind in order to do some tasks. And this kind of power is not relying solely on yourself to create it, and then you can succeed. Indeed, the mind quality also needs to be considered. If your quality belongs to the positive energy and your mental settings are positive, then for those you can link up with, or the results achieved by you will be much better. However, if your mind quality is negative, then no matter how you visualize or how you ask for help from any Yidam, Buddha and Bodhisattva, but when the nature of your mind is very negative, you still cannot be rescued. As such, that is to say, the focus of our Dharma practice is on mind training. But mind training is the most difficult part, as many people do not know how to practice on mind training. Is it just asking us to have a bit of compassion? Treating others a bit better, is that good enough? Actually, this kind of mental power is very minimal, not very workable, and insufficient. Then, what should we do? This is what I am talking about now, in the other mind training episodes, and this is the key point to be talked about starting from the 16th lecture onwards. To start teaching you with how to use the criteria for mind training in order to make some judgments and standards for dealing with matters. That is, we have to take mind training as the foundation. In order to be doing well in our Dharma practice, we need to develop some kind of criteria for judgments and in dealing with matters. Actually, there are many different layers for these criteria. And the most basic layer is that we have to learn and understand how to distinguish between right and wrong. A lot of people may think that is easy. However, if you continue listening, you will find that it is not easy at all. To learn about this, it is already a kind of wisdom. It turns out that after understanding this, no matter how we practice in our Dharma practice, there will not be deviations, and be comparatively more accurate to achieve what we want to do. So, this is a very important part. To illustrate and explain this, I have especially cited the most well-known curriculum as has been conducted by Professor Michael Sandel from the Harvard University of the United States. Currently, this is the most popular course, with published books and DVDs, and even being uploaded to the YouTube, and also quite popular in China, Korea and Japan. It can be claimed as an upsurge. Professor Sandel was invited to make public speech in Japan. The entrance tickets were speculated to go up more than 10 times. For just one entrance ticket, it cost more than $1,000. Why is there an enormous attraction generated from what he said, or from the case studies as presented by him? To be so popular around the world? Especially in Asia, it is so very popular now. I have also cited some cases from this popular course. This course, named as Justice, What's the Right Thing to Do?, consisted of 12 lessons. This course had broken all the university history records for the last 375 years of the Harvard University. All the records were broken. From 1980, when this course was introduced, there was only 15 persons attending. It is because talk about philosophy seems to be a boring thing. Nobody would like to go to listen. But now, it has more than 1,000 students attending for each of the lessons. Why is it so outstanding? It has made an accumulation of over 15,000 students, and these 15,000 persons are not ordinary people. They are elites from all walks of life, and all of them are coming from the Harvard University. Now, they have become the management staff of many large organizations in the world. They are the elites. And the number of students attended this course, as compared to the most popular course at Harvard University, is 400 to 500 people higher. For each lesson, the number of students attended is also higher than all the others. Beginning in the year 2009, the Harvard University has publicly broadcasted this course to the whole world via the Internet. This was, in the American TV history, the first time that a course has been broadcasted on the public TV. And this is also the one and the only one. No more. There is not a second course that can be compared with this course. This is also recognized publicly, and agreed by the U.S. government, to allow business organizations to be able to deliver this course. This is the one and the only one. So, what is good about this course? In view of this, let us pick out some cases from it for us to explain the setting up of the foundation of mind training. As the auxiliary teaching material on how to judge the right and wrong, in our last lecture, we talked about how to make a correct choice. If we make a choice for the sake of rescuing some more people, while letting some people die, then is this way of doing a right thing, or is it a wrong one? Can we do that? I would like to cite a real-life case. This case happened in 1884. At that time, the Queen of England went to court with two persons. She went to court with Dudley and Stephen. Dudley was the captain of the ship. There were four persons on board originally. The captain was called Dudley. Under him, there were crew members, that was Stephen, together with a sailor called Brooks, and Parker who was a waiter doing chores. This Parker was only 17 years old and had his first voyage to sea. When this Parker planned to go out to sea, his friend said to him, saying he was too young, there were many things that he would not know how to handle. It could be said that his life experience was very shallow, but had to go to sea already. In fact, going out to sea was isolated from the society, a place so far away, where he couldn't get any help. So, his friends advised him not to go out to sea. But Parker felt that he was so young, he should have more life experience in his own lifetime. So, there was no need to be afraid. Thus, he did not listen to the advice of his friends and went on board. But, unfortunately, this British merchant ship sank at sea. After the shipwreck, these four men, the captain, Stephen, Brooks and Parker, fled to the lifeboat. The name of this lifeboat was called Mignonette, which is the lifeboat shown to you on the screen. They drifted on this lifeboat for 24 days and were rescued on the 24th day. But at the time when they were rescued, there were only three persons left. Why was this happened? It was at that time, during the 24 days of sea drifting, they were very hungry, but there was no water and no food. And this Parker, due to his shallow life experience and was very stubborn, he did not listen to other people's advice, and he drank seawater. At that time, the captain and other crew members had already advised him. Drinking seawater would make people sick and also getting even more thirsty. Instead of quenching thirst, one would be more thirsty and would get sick. And that was how they advised him not to do so. But he did not listen. He drank it still. After drinking, he vomited and got diarrhea. and he was sick to the extent of dying. As they did not know when they would be saved, so this captain made a suggestion and said, "Use drawing lots to decide who is going to die. Give the flesh and blood to the rest of the people to maintain their lives, and wait for the rescue. That is to say, use blood to quench your thirst and use flesh to satisfy your hunger." At that time, Sailor Brooks had opposed, so it was not carried out. On the next day, the captain asked Sailor Brooks to look at the other side, avoiding to look at the side of Parker. Then, he took a pink knife and went to Parker and said to Parker, "Since you are dying soon, it is better for you to satisfy us." After saying some prayers, he pushed his pink knife into Parker's jugular vein. Parker was killed. After killing Parker, though Brooks opposed to eating flesh and drinking blood at that time, he couldn't stand hunger himself while watching both of them to eat meat and drank blood. He ended up eating flesh and drinking blood as well in order to maintain his own life. On the 24th day, a German ship appeared. And this captain, recording in his diary, he himself wrote this, "On the morning of the 24th day, when I was having breakfast, I saw a ship appeared and saved us. He treated the flesh of Parker, who was sacrificed as breakfast, that was extremely disrespectful, but they all thought that was what it should be. For this case, I have actually explained the answer in the last lecture. But why do we talk about it one more time today? It is because the answer I have said is, under Buddhist Dharma, how it should be done and how to look at it. This is a conceptual idea. But what is it like in a real world? I want you to face it and know about it. The truth of reality, how is it like? How does the reality look like?" In the last lecture, the 17th lecture, talking on the moral level, there were many Harvard students who had expressed their views. Some felt that was right while some said that was wrong. They had explained their moral views. And we, as Buddhist learners, all those present at that time were Buddhist learners, had also expressed their opinions. And I had also explained the answer at the Buddhist Dharma level. The reason for me to say the answer first, but not explaining the side of the reality, is because I was afraid that you might just listen to one lesson. And when you heard about the reality was like this, you might not know, or did not understand, how the Buddhist Dharma would come to see this matter. If that is the case, then I am afraid that you would mistakenly establish your standards of doing things. So, you will go the wrong way. And because of that, I told you the answer first, and subsequently explain what happened to the reality. So today's lecture, the 18th episode, is to tell you, in the real world, what actually happened? And what was the ending? Also, under the aspects of the law and of the Buddhist Dharma, how could they be able to face up to these challenges? As I have already explained the viewpoints from the Buddhist Dharma, so how did it look under the law? But for reality speaking, can we bear these challenges? Actually, is there any conflict between the idea and the actual reality? Why is there a fight within the aspect of the law in the real world? Why is there a fight with each other? In this case study, why do they fight with each other? Also, for this case, why has it become even nowadays, from the year 1884 till now at the year of 2012, of having gone through so many years, still a case of dialectic and debate in all of our well-known law schools by today? Why? There must have some reasons. This case must have some characteristics, so after going through so many years, it has been more than 120 years, and this case still has its existence value. Now, let us start from the beginning of that event. The incident began on September 6, 1884, when this Dudley and Stephen, as well as Brooks, these three men were rescued by a German ship and were brought back to the Falmouth port in England on September 6, 1884. Immediately, they were detained by the police and were required to appear in court on September 8. However, they were temporarily imprisoned again because it was a hearing only, and they would be tried in court on September 11. At that time, this case, after the 8th to the 11th, was reported on newspapers and media and spreading out at its full speed. Just for a few days, it had been widely reported and even become a great news across the UK and around the world. In Falmouth, the public opinion was obviously tended to sympathize with the three accused. Falmouth was a port. It was because they came ashore here, were caught here, and were put on trial here also. And in this Falmouth port there were several cases happened in the past. All were related to maritime events. You have to understand that at that time in the 19th century, their main means of transportation was the ship. Therefore, all the cases happened concerning the sea were very critical to most of them. Because they often went out to the sea, they might face the same problem. So, what happened in the cases, they felt very much related to themselves. They would tend to have bias towards the survivors of the sea incident. In relation to the accusation of these three defendants encountering these things at sea, they took it as their own business, thinking that they would be like this in the future. So, they were very sympathetic to the three accused. On September 18th, when another trial was held, one of the prosecution lawyers, named Banquerts, thought that Brooks was innocent in this case, because he had opposed the use of drawing lots to eat human flesh and he did not want to kill Parker. Therefore, Danquartz requested the court to turn Brooks into a witness in order to save him and let him not be charged. At the time all the judges agreed. As a result, from the original accusation of three people, it was changed to only two. And only Dudley and Stephen were left as the defendants. Therefore, this case was again delayed until November 7, 1884. So, from mid-September to early November, 1.5 months, the court adjourned. During the adjournment, the media discussed the matter widely and everyone discussed and argued about the case, arousing the extreme attention of the public opinion. In the Buddhist Dharma, this is known as the collective karma, that is, a joint action, an action that is performed together. Karma is action, it does not mean activity. This karma means action, that is a kind of energy produced by the common actions of the people. This energy was extremely huge at the time. It was a big pressure of public opinion. It could be said that the sentiment was surging. And this surging sentiment had become the core of the turning point for the case afterwards in the real world. This was also making this case to get so much discussion later, even until now, such that law schools have continued to take this case as a classic example for debate, and that is the reason. Because the surging sentiment was very serious at that time, so if the judge dared to find them guilty, like a death sentence, then there might be riots. If they were sentenced to life imprisonment, many people might make demonstrations. The situation at the time had come to this serious level. On November 7, 1884, the district court in Exeter, England, reopened for the trial. The presiding officer was a baron, he was called Huddleston. The prosecution lawyer was the Queen's Counsel Charles. The defense lawyer was also not weak, he was also a Queen's Counsel, named Collins. So, the strongest versus the strongest. The two strongest were fighting against each other. Both sides were using Queen's Counsel, as the attention of the whole world was being placed on this very case at the time. And this presiding judge, Baron Huddleston, was fully aware of the passion of the local jury. All these jurors were the residents coming from the Falmouth port. In fact, the entire jury was biased and sympathetic to the defendants. Other than the fact that the presiding judge knew that the entire jury was thinking to sentence the defendants to sinlessness even before the start of the trial. He also had to resolve another problem, necessity. What is necessity? When murder cases were put on trial, people would only look into one thing. Was there such a necessity to kill people? That is, if there was the necessity and if you could prove that there was the necessity to kill people, then you could use this necessity to justify the defense. It might be because of this, the defendant would become innocent or could be judged lighter. The presiding judge thought that if he wanted to handle impartially, if he wanted to use the humanitarian standpoint to look at this matter, he had not only to convince the jury, but also had to argue with them about the matter of necessity. Because if they could prove that this was a necessity, this murder case trial could accept necessity as a justification for the defense, so that this killing necessity could be a justification for the defense. Thus, the murderer would be forgiven. And this Huddleston always had a reputation by giving others a feeling that he was a very strong and powerful judge. His words were very persuasive. He was widely recognized as fully capable of guiding the jury. He was a powerful judge who could guide the jury to listen to his words. At that time, during the trial, Dudley and Stephen did not plead guilty. Not to plead guilty means that there should have a lawsuit. The defense had repeatedly raised the principle of necessity. They emphasized that there was really a necessity to kill people. In the defense, they put forward a lot of justifications about necessity. Then the prosecution, that was the presiding judge, the baron, made brief illustrations for some legal points of view and dismissed the arguments of the necessity made by the defense. Statements made by the defense were retorted one after one. He refuted all the arguments. However, the jury was not persuaded. Therefore, the baron, the presiding judge, invited the jury to make an adjournment. Then he presented a complete plan for solution to the jury. This plan was, he said to the jury, "You accept my guidance and confirm that the two defendants are guilty of murder. Or, if you don't accept it, you can give a special verdict." What is a special verdict? Special verdict means the jury only describes the facts found in the case. That is, they just say what they found in the case and what they saw only. And these must be facts. They cannot make any ruling on this case. That is, the jury cannot express something like this: "We feel that they are guilty," or "We unanimously decided they are guilty and sentenced to jail," or "To sentence them to acquittal," or "To sentence them to death." All these are not permitted. That is, if the jury accepts this special verdict, the jury is equivalent to giving up the right of judgment. They can only reflect the facts that they found. Then, the facts are given to the judge, who then decides whether or not the defendant is guilty according to the facts that they have discovered. That is, the power to conviction will be returned to the judge. This is called a special verdict. I will now ask you some questions. Can you see the mystery of the complete plan proposed by the judge? Can anyone see it? Please raise your hand if you can see it. You have to see the mystery of it, and you can answer the questions that follow. Then you can understand what kind of ending would be developed in reality, and then it would have such a development. This is the mystery of it. Does anyone see where the mystery lies? Can you see it? Please raise your hand if you can see it. If you don't raise your hand, that means you can't see it. Why do you raise your hand? Can you see it? Please raise your hand if you can see it. Most people cannot see the mystery. Please raise your hand if you can see it. Does anyone see it? He has raised hand. He can see it. Where is its mystery? The judge got this out. Where is the mystery? The presiding judge leads the jury not to make a verdict of innocence. I'm pretty good. You can see it. In fact, this judge knew that if the jury was allowed to make a judgment, the jury would certainly come up with the verdict of innocence. It was because they were all residents from the Falmouth port. They were all biased and sympathetic to the defendants. If the judgment was made by the jury, they would be acquitted. But the judge just thought that they ate people, and without the consent of Parker, they ate his flesh, which was wrong. I had already said it in the last lesson. From the perspective of the Buddhist Dharma, even if Parker agreed, they could not eat him. Besides, at that time, they did it without his consent. They killed him and ate him. Treated him as breakfast and paying no respect to him. The judge certainly wanted to change people's views. But he also knew that if the judgment was given to the jury, they would certainly make a verdict of innocence. So, how did he make this subtle layout and deceive the jury? That was, just giving them two choices. There was not a third choice. Only giving out two choices, then how did he abolish the judgment ability of the jury? How to guide them to automatically give up their own abilities? What could be done to succeed? How to do it to be considered as cunning? Therefore, the judge invited the jury to adjourn the meeting. He said, "I give you two choices. The first is that you have to admit that the accused has committed murder. If you don't pick this one, you can choose a special verdict." Of course, the jury would not choose the first one. If they chose this, the judge would be happy, and the judge wanted them to choose this one too. But he also knew that they would not choose. So, he guided them to choose the other one, which is a method called special verdict, let the jury, giving up their own judgment rights. In the United Kingdom, under the law, the special verdict referred to the jury waiving their power to judge the case and admitted that they could not make a judgment. They could only reflect the reality of the event and then hand it over to the judge to make the verdict. This was called a special verdict. In other words, this special verdict was applicable only if the jury admitted that they did not have the ability. It was not known what the presiding judge said to the jury, which had made the jury to feel that they did not have the ability. As a result, the jury promised him. Now I want to ask a question. Do you think that the judge in doing this, is it right or wrong? Think that he is right, please raise your hands. Think that he is right to do so, please raise your hands. The one raises his hand, please give me an explanation. Is there anyone who can explain? Why do you think that the judge is right to do this? Why do you think that he is doing the right thing? Almost half of you have raised your hands. I want to hear the reasons. You must explain with a reason, because in the future, after knowing the ending, you will wonder why that is so. So please explain why. Why do you raise your hands? Hello, gurus. I think this is because the judge does not want the people in the port to be biased to one side and to come up with only one conclusion. But the principle of the law is to be fair. You should not design a trap to calculate others. As a presiding judge, he should be fair and just. But now, besides being unfair and unjust, he has also designed traps for others. In this way, this is a violation of the principle of fairness of the law. Actually, is this correct to do so? Is it correct? I think it is okay. Do you still think he is right? Yes, because the law is something dead. Thank you. Is there any other opinion? Because the judge has this tool to use, so he used this tool. But I think there is another reason behind this. If the judgment is really handed over to the jury to make an innocence verdict, there will be many similar innocence cases in the future. And the whole society will be muddled. I have thought about it from this perspective. Good, is there any other supplement? I guess at that time, people in the whole society or region, their views are biased towards the defendants. The jury will be under a lot of pressure because there is not much for them to choose. When the judgment is made, they have to face their friends and relatives. So, the judge may think that he can withstand these pressures. It is better for him to take up these responsibilities. In addition, if the whole society has already had a judgment in their minds before starting the trial, it is actually not respecting the court. In this case, the judge makes such a suggestion himself. Because in the situation at the time, there was no choice. It was either to follow the society, or it would be viewed by law. If a judgment was given to the jury, it was to follow the society. If he made the choice, it would be looked upon from a legal point of view. It might be fairer. It is very good. Thank you. Is there any other opinion? Gurus. The two defendants really killed people, ate the flesh of others, and drank the blood of others. They had really committed a crime. So, I choose the first one. The judge designed this trap and abolished the power of the jury to make a judgment. There is, actually, a principle of fairness in the law, and yet he is now abolishing the principle of fairness. Do you think that he is right to do so? Yes. Thank you. Now, does anyone think that it is wrong for the judge to do so? Please raise your hands. I think the judge is wrong, because it is his own subjective belief that the two people are guilty of murder. He ignored all aspects of the matter. Just because he felt that both of them were guilty, he used his tricks to make the two people guilty. That is paranoid. That is not objective. That is not objective, unfair. Okay, thank you. Let us continue. In the laws of nature, every act that you have done will plant a cause and there will be a fruit to it. There must be cause and effect. Whether the thing you do is right or wrong, in fact, there will still be a fruit. And we have to pay attention to these fruits. Let us take a look now. Finally, this presiding judge had made the jury to accept his proposed special verdict. It turned out that this baron had deliberately planned to have this special verdict written a day ago. This special verdict was produced without discussions with the jury. Originally, it was supposed to have discussions with the jury to reach a consensus, and then wrote down the consensus and became a special verdict. It should be done in this way. But he did not follow this way. Instead, he created it himself. He wrote the special verdict one day before. Then he invited the jury to adjourn and have discussions. When the jury promised, he took out the special verdict and read it out sentence by sentence, asking the jury to confirm. There was no objection at the time. But some jury officers requested that some views be added to the special verdict. However, the presiding judge stated that these views had been incorporated into his special verdict provisions. He was not willing to write separately. The rationale he used was already written. It has been written within the provisions. Therefore, he would not write it again. And the last sentence of the provisions wrote, in the context of the whole incident, whether the prisoners are guilty of murder, based on various circumstances, in any case, because the jury has admitted that they are ignorant, it is necessary to refer this case to the court to determine what is the legal consequence which follows from the facts which they have found. The jury was originally handing the case over to the judge to make the verdict. As a result, this judge did not make a verdict. He only wrote in the special verdict the sentences shown just now. The presiding judge himself did not decide whether to judge them guilty or not guilty. And he dared not say it himself. At that time, the jury listened to him and said that they were ignorant and accepted his special verdict proposal and handed him the judgment. Unexpectedly, the judge did not make the judgment, and at the end, he just wrote, "They say that they are ignorant and need to refer this case to the court for judgment." For this incident, you can find out how the case was explained by Professor Michael Sandel, a philosophy professor of the Harvard University, from the following website. And this Baron Huddleston once again gave the defendants parole and deferred for trial. The trial would be held on November 25th at the Royal Courts of Justice in London. This case was originally a case of a local court. This presiding officer was originally a judge of the local court. After he arranged a special verdict, he did not make a judgment himself. He only said that on November 25th, the case would be transferred from Falmouth Port to the Intermediate Court of London for trial. Before the trial opened on November 25th, the presiding judge suddenly found, in his special verdict manuscript, he made some important and potentially fatal mistakes. What were the fatal mistakes? It turned out that he misrepresented the lifeboat of Mignonette as the British merchant ship that had sunk. Further, he had described that lifeboat as an open boat with paddles. And he did not identify its provenance on the Mignonette. He found that if he made these mistakes, it would obscure the eyes of the judges of the intermediate court, and they might make wrong judgments, such that it would affect the verdict. Therefore, before the special verdict had been submitted to the Royal Court of Justice in London, he revised the special verdict without authorization. This had made the version seen by the jury in the district court different from the version finally presented to the Royal Court of Justice in London. He took out the document which was confirmed by the jury on that day, because there must be a confirmation before it could become a formal legal document, and he revised it before it was handed over to the intermediate court. The document handed over to the intermediate court was therefore different from the document that was previously confirmed. He recalled the lifeboat as Mignonette and rewrote the lifeboat as a yacht. On November 25, 1884, in Cornwall and Devon Winter Assizes, Court No. 2 of the Royal Court of Justice in London, the case was reopened for trial. Why was it called the Winter Assizes? Because it was seasonal. Assizes was a synonym only. This name was used to all tried cases in the intermediate court. At that time, at that stage, another group of people would handle the judgment. The person in charge was the Attorney General, who was called Sir Henry James. He pointed out that according to the Queen's Bench was the High Court. The provisions stipulated that when dealing with any legal provisions, a group of judges was needed to work together for establishing their authority. As this case had caught the attention of the whole world, if a judgment was made by citing this provision, it would become a quotable case that could be cited in the future. He said that since it was so important, it was necessary to find more judges to come to the trial. Only then, the authority could be established. Otherwise, in the future, how to make the public convinced? Secondly, it was necessary to have a judgment made by the lower court first. After the judgment for guilty and punishment, it could then be handed over. Because according to the law, it was necessary to do so, the procedure was like this. It should be after the judgment was made, and if someone needed an appeal, it could be handed over to the intermediate court for trial. However, at that time the Attorney General said that there was neither innocent nor guilty penalty judgment in this case. There was nothing. And there was only a special verdict which said that it was necessary to be handed over to the court to judge. However, the local court itself did not make a judgment and handed it over to the intermediate court. Therefore, he suggested that it should not be interrogated in the Court of Winter Assizes, and it would be better to change to the Queen's Bench, the High Court, and to add more judges for the trial. And his rationale was that all the judges of the High Court had the power to interrogate the cases of the lower court. The presiding judge of the district court, that was the Baron Huddleston, who arbitrarily changed the judgment, raised doubts. He asked, could the judges be added when the trial had begun? There were already two or three judges. But he also hoped that the High Court would give him an affirmative answer. Because in his mind, he just wanted an affirmative answer, that was, the murderer is guilty. He felt that only him, just one person, was not powerful enough, thus he handed the case to the intermediate court subtly. If it could be tried by the High Court, it would be even better. So, he repeatedly thought about it, and being doubtful initially, he changed to be supportive to hand over the case to the High Court for trial. And would the defense lawyers agree? The defense lawyer was Collins of the Queen's Counsel. He began to suspect that the presiding judge Baron Huddleston had rewritten the judgment of special verdict. He requested him to submit a handwritten shorthand version for checking. Because at that time, each sentence was read out, and then confirmed by the jury accordingly. Then, the stenographer was there to be responsible for recording all the confirmed contents. Collins wanted to get the handwritten shorthand version to proofread the current print version, because he felt that the content had been amended. Therefore, both parties were arguing vigorously. Therefore, the Attorney General pointed out that the current lawsuit seemed to be a mess. The case was ordered to be re-examined and the defendants reappeared at another hearing in London on December 2nd. On December 2nd, just a few days later, the situation changed. The Attorney General gave his personal advice and instructions, asking for direct interrogation by the High Court and adding more judges. Surprisingly, the defense lawyers did not refute and challenge him. Under normal circumstances, the defense lawyers would feel that it is better for them to have more favorable conditions. So, for them, the fewer judges, the fewer opinions, that would be the best. However, unexpectedly, they did not challenge the Attorney General's proposal. Therefore, the media speculated that in these 2 days, the defense lawyer Collins might have reached some agreements with the prosecutor. Some promises of clemency had reached. It should be that some commitments had been reached. So the defense did not object to being referred to the High Court for trial directly. Since everyone did not have any opinions, the case was postponed until December 4, 1884. On December 4, the trial was held in the Queen's Bench, that was the High Court. Members consisted of 5 judges. The Chief Justice, that was the presiding judge, called Coleridge. There were 4 judges under him. Totally, there were 5 judges to put this case on trial. What a great pomp! As for the prosecution, in addition to the Attorney General, there were 3 prosecution lawyers. It was also a big pomp. The Attorney General, Sir James, proposed, there is no such power of any common law that can be used to support necessity as a defense justification for murder cases. He said no. There was no such thing in law. He refuted and said, "There is no such thing in the common law. Murder is murder. In murder cases, how can it be said that it is a necessity and then to go for the murder? This cannot be made as a justification. Unless you are based on self-defense, or because you want to kill this person avoiding a third person to be killed by him, that is, you are saving people. For example, if you kill Hitler, making Hitler not to kill more people. In this case, you can take the killing of Hitler as a justification for the necessity of killing. Apart from the reason for self-defense, and the reason for saving more people, where you can use this necessity as a defense justification, otherwise, it is not permitted. But in this case, it is obvious that this situation is not applicable. So, the defense lawyer made a rebuttal. They had three persons, and how did these three lawyers fit? The problem started to appear here. Collins cited a famous case from the United States. It turned out that in 1842, more than 40 years ago, there was a case happened in the United States. It was the U.S. government versus Holmes. The situation was similar to the current British Queen accused the two individuals. It turned out that a few decades ago, the United States had the same court case. It was the U.S. government accused Holmes case. The defense lawyer now cited this case as an example. He also quoted what had said by many philosophers, great writers at the time, or what was said at the theoretical level. All of these were taken out as arguments to prove necessity. The defense lawyer believed that there should have two things in law. The first one was the existence of unavoidable necessity. Because you could not avoid it, you must kill people. If you did not kill him, all of them would have to die. Would starve to death. This was called the unavoidable necessity. The second one was self-survival. Since we lived in the world, as human beings, we had a responsibility to let ourselves continue to survive. This was a very great universal principle of self-preservation. Therefore, the combination of these two would become a necessity. So, we could kill him. He also added, for a criminal act, such as murder, if it was based on these two reasons, that would be excusable, and even allowed to be a defense justification. Even though it was not permitted by the judge, he would still take it out for defense. I will now ask you a question. Do you agree with the arguments put forward by the defense? He has said two justifications. The first one is unavoidable necessity. The second one is that we live in this world. We have the responsibility to keep ourselves continue to live. Hence, suicide is not acceptable. In order to survive, the environment at that time must kill people to survive, so it proves that is a necessity. Can these justifications be used in court to justify the defense? Is the defense lawyer saying it right? If you agree that his approach is correct, please raise your hands. But, no one raises hands. Those disagree, please raise your hands. There are many people. You are getting to understand the Buddhist Dharma more and more. Then, can you explain this? Explain why do you disagree? What he said, it seems to make sense. If you further listen to his real case again, you may find it difficult to make your choice. You may change your mind. Can anyone explain this? Why do you raise your hands to disagree, two gurus? If the self-survival is based on being threatened by others, or posing a threat, such as pointing a knife at me, then, it can be established. The person who was eaten was just a person who was dying soon. How could he threaten them? Those ideas of these murderers are all for themselves, advocating their own self-worthiness, putting themselves in infinity while degrading the value of others. That is a very good answer. Let us take a look at whether it is possible in the law, and in the Buddhist Dharma, is it okay? In fact, in the 19th century, you looked at its background, it turned out to be very terrible. In 1884, that was the 19th century, all their traffic was almost at sea, and the traffic was very busy. So, they constituted a traditional custom of the sea. Everyone would use it, and every country in the world would use it. This custom of the sea was such that after the ship sank, the survivors left behind, they had the right to decide. By means of drawing lots, who would be slaughtered and eaten so that other people could continue to survive. So, At that time, the captain thought that his proposal for drawing lots to kill someone was right. But Brooks did not agree, so it was pulled down. Therefore, the captain decided not to draw lots. Finally, he chose to kill the one who might die soonest or to kill the weakest one. Originally, there was another one called maritime law. The maritime law was a real law. This maritime law attempted to use the law to outlaw this practice of the custom of the sea. Thus, this case became a very sensational case in the British Victorian era. At that time, Queen Victoria was still the Queen of Britain. The reason for sensation in the case was that, when the public opinion and the folk sentiment were competed with the law, which one will win? Because if the law won, history could be rewritten from then onwards. If it was still the folk sentiment won, this custom of the sea could not be shaken. It would still be cited as an excuse for a lawsuit. So, at that time, the defense lawyers proposed this custom of the sea, saying that it had always been the case. Nothing could be done by the captain. In fact, he was doing it in accordance with the custom of the sea. And he was not creating a kind of murderous idea himself. He just followed his predecessors to do it. Why was it that the predecessors were right for doing it, but it was wrong for him to do it? And even he would be sentenced to death? So, we had said before, if you sentence him to death, or to life imprisonment, it would lead to riots and demonstrations. This was the reason. Because everyone was doing in this way. However, the maritime law at that time was to help to outlaw this custom of the sea and to compete with it. This was the situation at the time. Why was this kind of cannibalism incident in sympathy? The rationale for public opinion was that this group of people had been cast away. But what was cast away, that was, people were already far away from society. Left the land, to be at sea. They had nothing to do with society. They walked together. In this way, they were cast away. Since, they walked together, and of course they could have their own set of laws. In fact, they themselves had their own rules of survival that would not affect our society. In order to survive, whoever ate who, was no longer a problem. This was their mentality. Why did the United States government engage in a lawsuit with Holmes? How did the lawsuit come about? It was 43 years ago, there was a case in the United States, and this case became a precedent. And this precedent was also cited in this case, as a defense justification. In 1841, an American ship called William Brown sank after hitting an iceberg. One of the crew members was called Holmes. Holmes drove the lifeboat and carried many of the rescued passengers on it. But the boat was too small and too crowded. He thought it was overloaded and the lifeboat was in danger of sinking. If every one of them was crowded on this ship, and it would definitely sink. So, he pushed 14 to 16 passengers into the cold water. It was very cold at that time, and they would definitely die if being pushed down. As a result, all of them were really dead. Thus, he pushed 14 to 16 passengers into the cold water in order to save the remaining passengers. As he believed that because there were too many people, someone must make sacrifices. The boat was driven by him and he was a crew member, so he made the decision. By pushing 14 to 16 passengers to the sea, they could return to the United States safely and successfully. When they returned to Philadelphia, Holmes was immediately arrested and the U.S. government charged him with murder. And the U.S. government accused him of murder. Let us see what the reality was like. At that time, the great jury, being called the great jury, that meant to have many people in the jury. They all agreed unanimously to reject this indictment, despite the fact that it was the government. The jury said that if he was accused of murder, they would not accept it, they would not make a trial. So, they were asked, how would they be willing to make a trial? They replied that if it was converted to manslaughter, they would be willing to make a trial. The government then reluctantly replaced it with a manslaughter. After that, he was judged by manslaughter. The case was tried in the U.S. Circuit Court of the Eastern District of Pennsylvania. It was the intermediate court. The judges at the time had a partiality for the jury. They guided the jury and said that the law of necessity could be used as a complete defense approach. At that time, the American judges said that in this case of manslaughter, necessity could be used to reply. But now, the case was in the UK and was being trialed in the High Court. They all said that trials in the High Court would be better. In order to suppress the US Intermediate Court, it had to be trialed at a higher level High Court. For this reason, the British judges had reached an agreement unanimously at an earlier time, not to be trialed in the Intermediate Court, but to be handed over to the High Court. If the judges of the US Intermediate Court said that necessity could be used as a complete defense approach, so, what method could be used for saying no? The method was to go to the High Court for trial. To go to the High Court for trial was to stop the necessity be made as a justification for complete defense. The defense lawyers thought that if the United States could use necessity as a justification for defense, why was that could not be used in the UK? In fact, the judges in the United States had mentioned, before the law, if it is cited for protection, it must be proved beforehand that this is a necessity case. It is necessary to have these conditions. The first is that the slayer must be faultless. For example, if he really wanted to kill, he just chopped down directly. Instead of slowly tortured the deceased, or used other strange killing methods. That was, it was necessary to kill and there was no missing. That was, not doing some bad behavior to entertain yourself. And there was no missing. The second, he owes no duty to the victim. That was, he had no responsibility or owing a debt to the victim. Killing him was not because of money or other interests. However, in the case of the United States, the crew murderer was actually owed. Because the crew was as responsible as the captain to protect the passengers. They were responsible for protecting passengers' safety. If a sacrifice was needed, you must sacrifice yourself first, instead of sacrificing passengers first. So, in the ship sinking case of the Italian Costa Concordia cruise ship that took place on January 23, 2012, that captain, at the first instant, took a lifeboat and escaped. Left behind on board were those passengers who could not escape because of insufficient lifeboats. They had to take care of themselves. This would be accused because the captain was responsible. He owed the passengers, because his duty was to protect the passengers. Why could he be the first one to leave? In fact, he should be the last one leaving. So, the American judge said that there were two things. First, you did not miss anything, there was no missing in your killing. The second was that you owed no duty to the victim. In this case, this necessity could be used as your justification for defense. Therefore, at the time, the jury judged Holmes guilty and said that he had a little fault. And just a little bit. He had the necessity to kill people. If he did not push the 14 to 16 passengers down, all people would die. And a lot more people would die. But if he killed these dozen people, he could save a lot more people. So, firstly, there should have this necessity. Secondly, he had not missed anything, just pushing them into the water. But he did not stab them with a knife before pushing them down. So, there was no missing. He owed a little, because he was a crew member, he should die first. It should be that he jumped into the water. He should be the 16th dead, so that one more person could be saved. But why was he not the 16th person who jumped into the water? Because he must drive the boat. None of the passengers could drive the boat. They would get lost in the boundless sea. They would never be back to Philadelphia if they did not know the directions. That was why he said that he could not die. Therefore, when he was pronounced necessity to kill, no judge would try to challenge this necessity. At the end, there was a light sentence for him. He was sentenced to 6 months imprisonment and a fine of $20. At that time, $20 might probably be a lot of money. But the imprisonment was 6 months only. Now, this British case cited the case of the United States. In the United States, it was only imprisonment for 6 months. If they were now sentenced to life imprisonment, definitely, someone would come out to demonstrate. But, if they were sentenced to death, someone would come out to riot. The public opinion at that time reached the point of turbulence which was caused by the light sentence of the American case. So, how could they make a severe sentence now? The situation of this American case was cited in the case of the Queen of England against Dudley and Stephen Now. As a criminal case in the United Kingdom, in the whole world of common law, that was referring to any place in the whole world using the common law, would be very tense about this case. Why? It was because for the outcome of this case, it would become the most important precedent case. So, it could not lose. If lost, it would be a great issue and here came the trouble. Anyway, it could not lose. But there would be riots in case of winning. What should be done between the two? In order not to lose, they proposed, necessity is not a defense to a charge of murder. At that time, it was a ruthless era when people were drinking blood and eating raw, and the strong oppressing the weak. They did not value morality and justice. Therefore, this group of judges, referred to the judges in the United Kingdom, not the judges in the United States, they hoped to elevate the human evolution. They tried to use the law to outlaw this custom of the sea. Thus, this case became a must-win case for the British common law in the Victorian era. It was necessary to win. And in the Buddhist Dharma, I have already said that it is to use the elevation or descent of the mind nature in order to determine right or wrong for the course of action. We also establish this principle to elevate the human evolution. Now I want to ask again, as just said, the judge of the district court used a plan to get the jury to fall into a trap. He said to the jury, "You must sentence them to sin, or else you have to choose the special verdict and give up your authority to judge. Then, the case is later judged by the intermediate court or the high court, it means it is to be decided by the court. As a result, the jury had no further ability to judge. For the practice of this judge of the local court, at that time, some of you raised your hands and felt that it was wrong. Also, some of you raised your hands and felt that it was right. Now I give you one more chance to raise your hands. When you have read the whole background, you know that this lawsuit must be won, and the consequences of losing are very serious. Those raised hands saying it is right, you should still think that is right. And the people who felt that was wrong before, is there anyone wants to make a change now, to say that it is right? If someone wants to make a change, can you explain why you want to change your mind now?" The guru. Because he wanted to use a new method to interpret the law. He didn't want the wrong behavior to reappear, so he used a new method to fix it. In fact, he wanted to make a correction. That is, he wants to bring order out of chaos, right? Thank you. In this case, you have to understand one thing. Actually, for every one thing, do not make your judgment so quickly. Because every one thing, when its phenomenon appeared at the very beginning, it will seem to be right. But it will seem to be wrong as well. When you have to make a judgment, you should find out the reasons behind the incident. Analyze it first, then make a judgment. Otherwise you will be wrong. Why do you have to make changes again just now? It is because you know the truth. But if we don't know, we will always think that the judge is wrong. In fact, this story teaches us that we must look more and analyze more. In the first place, to think that the presiding judge of the district court is wrong, saying that he is playing tricks and does not conform to the principle of fairness in law. This type is called absolutism. That is, he has violated this principle and I feel that he is wrong. I don't care what his reasons are, the law has to be fair. In the face of the law, everyone is equal, everyone is fair, and no tricks can be manipulated. This is called absolutism. That is to say, no matter when, he will say that it is wrong and will not change. These are all absolutism, that is, he has violated this principle and so that is wrong. If later, you consider that the presiding judge of the district court is correct, that is, a change has been made, that is, for the sake of overall civilization progress for mankind, we abandon the principle of fairness in law. Furthermore, we ignore any laws and principles of fairness, and just look at the most important thing. That is, we look at the overall civilization progress for mankind only. Is this belonging to utilitarianism or absolutism? Now I will ask you questions again. Do you think that if I change my mind like this, is it utilitarianism? I see that this seems not to be correct, and it is better to change my mind. Is this because I am utilitarian and change my mind? Or, am I a person of absolutism and change my mind? If you think it belongs to utilitarianism, please raise your hands. Can you explain this? Why do you think it is utilitarianism? That is, I originally think that the judge is wrong. But after I know the background, I know that he has such a big idea for the elevation of the human civilization, so, I think he is right. Is my change of mind belonging to utilitarianism? If you think that belongs to utilitarianism, can you explain why? Why is it belonging to utilitarianism? It is for the future of mankind to lay a principle to judge what is right and wrong. Do you think, when you look at one thing, and judge its right and wrong, you want to look at which is more favorable first? If this is more favorable, you will make a change. Do you think this way? Yes. So, you think that this is utilitarianism? Thank you. Then, I want to ask, is there anyone thinks that it is actually absolutism? Anyone raises his hand? Yes. Please speak. Because for the idea that he is having, he makes this decision. Therefore, he inclines to absolutism, not utilitarianism. Thank you. Actually, the answer is, there is no absolute standard answer. You have to remember that all the answers are relative. Why? Since the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had already said that things on earth are impermanent. Hence, there is no absolute, but only relative. Please let me explain it to you. If you think in this way, when I choose anything, I have an idea, and the idea is, as long as it is favorable, I will say it is right. If it is not favorable, I will abandon it and will not keep it. Even the principle, if the principle is not favorable, I will not keep it. If you will change at any time. And, you will make changes at any time in response to benefits. This kind of idea is called utilitarianism. That is to say, your change belongs to utilitarianism. In fact, it turns out to be different from person to person. If you change your mind, think this way, instead of thinking that it is more favorable, so you make the change. If your idea is, I only have one principle and my principle will never change. My principle is, when it makes the mind nature to elevate, it is right, and when it makes the mind nature to descend, it is wrong. You will use this principle for judging for everything. If so, just a moment ago, why did you think that the judge was wrong? It was because you felt that he was unfair. The way that the judge did would make people despise the law and would make people's mind nature to descend, so you felt that he was wrong. Later you knew that there were so many ideas behind him. It turned out that he was to elevate human civilization, that was, to elevate the mind nature of human beings. This was more in line with your principle. So, you changed your judgment and thought he was right. That was to say, you changed your feeling on his right and wrong, but not because of the change in interests. The same principle was used, and it had never been changed. This principle was that, if it made the mind nature to elevate, it was right. And if it made the mind nature to descend, it was wrong. So, the principle was not changed. The same principle was used for verification. Just now, you had not looked at it clearly, so it was verified wrongly. Now, you looked at it clearly, used the same principle to verify once again. Found that he was doing the right thing, and so you changed the answer. If you think this way, then you are absolutism. So, you have to remember, in today's lesson, it is to teach you that all things are always relative and not absolute. Even if you change your mind, or do not change your mind, whether you use utilitarianism or use absolutism, it turns out that it depends on how your mind nature thinks and decides. So, in the legal judgment, many times, it is based on your intention. Your thoughts at that time will be a very important factor that determines the severity of a conviction, and whether you are guilty or not. It is all determined by the tendency of your mind nature, that is, to see if your mind nature is good or bad. This is the way to consider it. So, you have to remember, it is always, when we handle things, from the perspective of Buddhist Dharma, the best to use absolutism. Of course, it is not a must for doing so, but it is the best to use absolutism. That is, you are always to hold on to one principle, and that principle will never change. This principle is, when a thing makes the mind nature to elevate, it is right. When a thing makes the mind nature to descend, it is wrong. And this principle is unchanged. We better use this principle. If you feel that you cannot do it, all the things you do now, you are using the utilitarianism. When considering things, you will first measure which one will have more benefits. Then, you will adopt the more beneficial one and give up the one with less benefits. If this is the case, many times you will be very prone to error. You will appear, sometimes the judgment is right and sometimes it is wrong. This phenomenon will occur, as you are always not stable and not long-lasting enough. Even when you have not enough mental concentration as well. So, you have to remember, if you want to get better mental concentration in your future training, these foundations must be made. You'd better be able to cultivate yourself to the level of absolutism. That is, you are just to hold one principle and never change it. This is the best. Let us talk about the story of the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni again. In Jatakas, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had a story about sacrificing his own life in order to feed a hungry tigress. In this case of sacrificing life to feed a hungry tigress, there are also two answers, the right and the wrong. If you could endure the pain, then you would be right. Why? It was because the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had practiced Dharma practice for numerous past lifetimes. His practice on compassion was stable and unaffected. At that time, he saw that a tigress was too hungry. The tigress wanted to eat one of its own cubs and wanted to upkeep its body to produce milk to feed the other cubs. The tigress hoped that one of the tiger cubs died could save the others. The story was telling about the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni, before he became a Buddha, met this situation, and wanted to save these tigers. So, he extended his head to the very hungry tigress in allowing it to bite him. He hoped that after the tigress had eaten himself, it could upkeep its body and had milk to feed the tiger cubs. This would save the mother tiger and the tiger cubs so that they did not have to starve. He did that at the time, is it right or wrong? You have to remember one thing. It is depending on whether he can endure the pain. When the tigress was not strong enough to eat him, it would first bite off one of his hands and rested for a while. After he was in pain for a few hours, it bit off his second hand. He was extremely painful, but he was not dead yet. Again, after he was in pain for a few hours, it bit off one leg. Another few hours later, the second leg was bitten off. In this way, his body was bitten to pieces, he was neither dead nor alive. For this painful process, are you able to withstand? If it is you, practicing Dharma practice for not many years, not having enough compassion, you will curse the tigress in the process. You are scolding, what a hell! You are slaughtering me now! You should bite my heart in one bite! You don't know how to bite to eat. You will curse the tigress continuously. Then later, you will hate the tigress. Your hatred will be following your pain and like an explosion busting out continuously. When you die, the negative energy of your hatred would be very strong. This kind of negative energy would take your mental consciousness to be reborn to some very bad places. At an instant, you would drop to the realm of animals or the realm of hungry ghosts and you would not know what you would be. Needless to say, it should be the worst situation. So, you have to remember. If you have Dharma practice for so many lifetimes like the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni, your Bodhicitta is very stable. And your mental concentration is also very strong. If you are not dead after bitten so many times, you can still bear it. However, you still have Bodhicitta and you feel that it is not to be cared about and let the tigress continue to bite you. You think that it is worthwhile to save these tigers. Therefore, you consider that it may be the debt owed in previous lifetimes. Let the tiger continue to bite, then the debt can be repaid. If you are able to do this, you are right. But if you can't stand the pain, it bites you, you scold, and you keep cursing, then your decision is wrong. Why? Because you will make your mind nature to descend and lead you to be reborn to some poor places in the future. Therefore, I said in my last lesson, to sacrifice, to allow cannibalism, is this right? Like this case, if Parker said, please kill me, you can eat me. Under this situation, if he promised, can you do it? In the Buddhist Dharma, this is not allowed. What is the reason? This is wrong. Why? It is because people have a mind to think and thus have thoughts, but tigers don't. In fact, tigers have always been eating meat, they do not know that this is wrong. So, they can never upgrade themselves, they cannot become human beings. As a result, they will get worse all the time, and will not be good. As in his incident, it did not get worse, because it was the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni who offered himself to be eaten. However, it got neither an elevation, nor a descent. They were still staying in the realm of animals. But if the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni could bear the pain, he could elevate, and if he could not stand it, he would descend. But cannibalism is another thing. For cannibalism, people know that this is not right. Also, people are already in the realm of human beings. If someone will eat human flesh, the degree of cruelty for that person will be very strong. This cruelty is a kind of strong negative energy. In the future, because of his poor mind nature, he would get a downfall for being reborn to the poor places. The downfall means a drop to a lower level for reborn. For example, he would be reborn in those places for animals and hungry ghosts. For cannibalism, even if you are willing to sacrifice yourself to allow them to eat, in fact, it will strengthen the degree of cruelty of that person. It will also make the mind nature of this person to descend. So, we have to know, before we decide whether to do something, the judgment of right and wrong from this matter will not be just looking at yourself. Not only you have to look at your own mind nature, but also you have to look at other people's mind nature. However, it is not just looking at other people, you also have to take care of yourself at the same time. Sometimes, you even have to care about how relatives and friends looking at this matter. You have to look at it this way. That is, we have to look at it comprehensively. For cannibalism, why is it wrong? It is because you have made bad deeds with good intentions. You hope to save him, but you have made his mind nature descend. In the future, this person would be reborn into a very poor place and would fall into the realm of animals. If falling into the realm of animals, it is easy to descend and hard to elevate. According to the scriptures, after a descent, it usually takes a very long time to ascend a little, and it is very difficult to elevate. In most cases, it is getting more and more downwards and the environment for reborn is getting worse and worse. How about getting more and more elevated? It is very difficult. So the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni told us that we must have Dharma practice when we are alive. Especially when we are human beings, because the realm of human beings is still a good environment. It belongs to one of the three virtuous realm and has not yet reached the bad situation. Once you fall, you will be difficult to elevate. If you are still on the upper level, there will be a greater chance to continue to rise. But it must be achieved by having Dharma practice. If you do not go for Dharma practice, since the present social atmosphere is poor, it is likely to be more and more descending. The main reason is that when the mind nature descends, it makes the reborn descend too. It is going all the way down. So, in China, during the famine period, or during the war, there were cases of child exchanging for eating. This situation is wrong. Therefore, in the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni's jatakas, there had never been a case of to sacrifice to allow cannibalism. Actually, there was no such thing. But there were cases for sacrificing lives to feed the tigers, or to save other living beings. There are cases for sacrificing lives to feed animals, but there is no one case for sacrificing to feed human beings. So when we have to develop some standards, or the foundation of the mind training, we must use wisdom to develop the standards. Can we develop it with compassion? In fact, the two must be linked together to establish it. But which one is the most important? It is wisdom. Why? Because compassion may have a blurred zone, For example, you may feel that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni sacrificed his life to feed the tigress, after that he can be promoted to become a Buddha. Therefore, I can learn from him. I am now like Parker, I will fulfill other people and let them eat my flesh. I allow the cannibalism, as you think that this is right. But, when you don't have wisdom and only have compassion, you will feel that this is correct. However, you are making bad deeds with good intentions, and you have hurt the person who eats you. In the future, his reborn would definitely descend. Furthermore, he would be a beast. Even if he is not a beast, he would be in the realm of hungry ghost. Actually, he is made that by you. That is to say, when we have to develop standards to judge the right and wrong, in fact, it must link wisdom and compassion together. Without doubt, it should be wisdom coming first. Wisdom should come first. Otherwise, if only compassion is used, you must be wrong. For example, when you see sacrifice life to feed the tiger in jatakas, you want to follow to sacrifice your life to feed the tigress. But you are unable to stand the pain. Then your decision is wrong. Therefore, whether it is sacrifice life to feed the tigress or sacrifice life to feed the human beings, however, wisdom is required. Now the presiding judge had proposed a complete plan to the jury. In fact, it is a violation of the principle of fairness of the law. From the perspective of Buddhist Dharma, is he right or wrong? And, in the law of cause and effect, what are the consequences of his handling methods? Actually, the overall civilization progress of human beings is very important. However, progress is not equivalent to the elevation of mind nature. Please don't make the mistake. If this kind of progress is helpful to the elevation of mind nature, it is right. Otherwise, it is not right. For example, in this case, what these judges had done was to elevate the overall civilization of human beings. And they did not want to have the phenomenon of the cannibalism again. It would make the overall mind nature of human beings to elevate. So, in this case, he was right. Since the elevation of the overall mind nature of human beings overrides the principle of fairness of law. The law was established by people, so it could not be said that established by people was necessarily right. Therefore, the elevation of mind nature was an important direction of overall civilization of human beings. Thus, it overrode everything, and also overrode the principle of fairness of the law. The law could be changed. But this principle could not be changed. This was just said by one of the classmates that the law could be changed. But Buddhist Dharma has only one principle. It cannot be changed. Making the mind nature to elevate, it is right, and making the mind nature to descend, it is wrong. However, this principle cannot be changed. And if the overall civilization progress of human beings makes the mind nature to descend, then it will be wrong. It just like some violent games. For example, many smartphones or computers have been invented now, and everyone will think that it is good. There is progress, because our communication of information is much faster now. But, we have to see that what this information is. Since, a smartphone is just a piece of item, but information is to be spread out by people. When the information spread around is very poor, all are violent, or some of that is with poor consciousness. In fact, you will seriously poison your next generation. That why was it easier to teach our children of previous generations? Although they were playing on the street and they were very sensible. In fact, most of them, 7 out of 10 kids, were very sensible and did not require your teaching. But the children nowadays are not the same. The children are much protected now. It is very difficult to teach them. But they are easily be influenced and can easily be wrongly taught by friends. Furthermore, it is easy to be misled by the media, or be wrongly educated by information. The reason is because the flow of information is very powerful now. For example, there is some circulated information saying, do not listen to the words of your parents. This is the best. This is the most independent. Consequently, there is a lot of bad information like this spreading around already. If it makes the mind nature to descend, it is all wrong. Is that the fault of the inventors? In fact, there is nothing to do with them. It is the fault of the person who flows out this information. Because the elevation of the overall mind nature of human beings overrides the liberalism of society. Freedom is not the biggest. The elevation of the mind nature, this principle overrides the liberalism of society. It is not the elevation of mind nature to follow the law. Instead, the law should follow the elevation of mind nature. The law should be amended for the elevation of mind nature. In the Bodhicitta precepts, there are many rules that cannot be violated. In the event of a violation, under what circumstances will it not be considered as a precept violation? The Bodhicitta precepts says, having compassion, heartwarming love, and mercy, these persons are exempted from the violation. The Bodhicitta precepts says, when you do this thing, you will violate the Bodhicitta precepts. But if it is done with a mind of compassion, or kindness, or mercy, then it is not considered as a precept violation. That is, there is no violation of the Bodhicitta precepts. However, it is not necessarily be right although there is no violation of the Bodhicitta precepts. Just like sacrifice life to feed the tigress, of course, there is no violation of the Bodhicitta precepts, but, in fact, is it right or wrong? If you make yourself continually curse that tigress, make the mind nature to descend and let yourself reborn to the realm of animals, this is wrong. So, remember, even if you don't violate the precepts, it doesn't equal to that which you are doing is right. Do you understand? It is still judged by the mind nature. You will find that we judge all the things, all to be around an axis. That axis is that, making the mind nature to elevate, that is, right, and making the mind nature to descend, it is wrong. If you use this method to look at things, you will know clearly whether the things are right or wrong. So, this presiding judge Baron Huddleston, if he is a Buddhist and has received the Bodhicitta precepts, he is considered not having a precept violation. But has he violated the law? You have to study it in law. All in all, he had used a power and he was a presiding officer. At that time, he was the most powerful person and he was the core of power. If he said this, the incident would be like this. If he said that, the incident would be like that. At that moment, he was the core figure in the case. Therefore, all power was centralized on him. Therefore, anyone who is in power should pay attention. He must be very careful to judge right and wrong. In this incident, he would rather sacrifice himself, and he would ignore his reputation. Since he wanted to elevate the civilization of human beings, the situations where people were cannibals, drank blood and ate raw must be rectified. It was necessary to have the law to outlaw customs of the sea. So, he would rather sacrifice himself and set the ploy. And setting this ploy, he believed that he was not illegal and he would not be prosecuted. In addition, he knew that he had this power in law. Then, he used the law as a tool to implement this task. So, he was using his strongest ability to save some people. Hence, he was not considered as breaking the law. And he was the right to do so. If you look at it from the perspective of Buddhist Dharma, he is right. He is not wrong, he is right. However, the mainstream of thinking at the time, the practice of customs of the sea, did not pay attention to morality and justice. It was really a kind of collective karma. Karma means action, which is a powerful energy. At that moment, the entire government did not dare to contend against this power. The judge was only a small group of people who tried to change this collective karma. Now, let us have a look. Firstly, what was the final trial result? Secondly, at that time, the crowd was in a state of surging and advocated acquittal. Would the judges betray the law and made a verdict of innocence? Or made a light sentence? Thirdly, in the end, could we use the law to bring order out of chaos and successfully elevated the overall civilization progress of human beings? Fourthly, can the Buddhist Dharma explain and conform to this kind of complicated daily life case? Fifthly, how can we use the wisdom of the Buddhist Dharma to solve the right and wrong problems of everyday life? Sixthly, will the Buddhist Dharma be challenged by these realistic results? Seventhly, In the law of cause and effect, what will be the consequence of the handling method of the presiding judge, Baron Huddleston? All these, let us talk about them in the next lecture. This is the end of this lecture. Today is to teach you how to use wisdom to formulate the basis of mind training. What is the basis of mind training? It is to establish a criterion for judgments in dealing with matters related to mind training. In fact, this is very important. Judging right and wrong is very difficult. This kind of criterion must be applicable to all daily life. It meets the standards of precepts and contains wisdom. It is possible to merge into the relative truth and the absolute truth. What is the relative truth? It is the law of cause and effect in our world. The absolute truth is the nature of emptiness, that is, everything is empty in Heart Sutra. Actually, when do we have to take everything as empty? When do we have to observe the cause and effect, and not to behave casually? Then, when do we observe the right and wrong for doing things? This is wisdom, and our first lecture, which was also the 16th lecture of our Essence on the Dharma Practice of Tibetan Buddhism. This was the first lecture of the mind training episode. It had explained what was, use mind nature to determine cause and effect. It turns out that in the entire natural system, the mind nature will determine the cause and effect. Our second lecture, which was also the 17th lecture of our Essence on the Dharma Practice of Tibetan Buddhism. That was the second lecture of the mind training episode. One thing had been taught, that was how to use the elevation or descent of mind nature to determine right and wrong. And in this lecture, the third lecture of the mind training episode is also the 18th lecture of our Essence on the Dharma Practice of Tibetan Buddhism. The criterion has been explained in this criterion of using the elevation or descent of mind nature to determine right and wrong overrides all worldly phenomena, relative truth. That is to say, when you judge right and wrong, it is not necessarily use the law, or the so-called principle of fairness, or liberalism, or the principle of respecting the individuals, etc., not using these to see things. All are depending on the mind nature, and our previous 15 lectures, if you want, you can revisit. The first lecture explains that, can you ensure that your Dharma practice is useful and works? The second lecture, what is the relationship between your destiny and Sahadeva? The third lecture, how to avoid the post-death trial and the abstruseness of the Pure Land. The fourth lecture, the method in figuring out the future destiny. The fifth lecture, the high degree of risks and danger in the post-death world. The sixth lecture, the characteristic tendency and karmic retributions and how it affects the destiny. The seventh lecture, how to make the spirits of the deceased to let go their attachment to greed. The eighth lecture, the impact of one's attachment to anger and hatred in afterlife. The ninth lecture, the frequently encountered problems on being trapped after death. The tenth lecture, after death dangers triggered by ignorance. The 11th lecture, what dangers would be encountered as it is proved that the life continues to exist after death? The 12th lecture, why we need to gain the mind's dominance in the spiritual realm. The 13th lecture, what are the disintegration processes in the post-death world? The 14th lecture, what are the dangers of non-religious spiritual training practices? The 15th lecture, the relationships of danger, opportunity, and mind nature in Dharma practice. The 16th lecture, that is mind training episode 1, how can we use wisdom to lay the foundation for mind training? The 17th lecture, that is mind training episode 2, how to balance the right and wrong in the gray areas. And the 18th lecture, that is also mind training episode 3, what is the principle of judging the right and wrong in Buddhist Dharma?